Making a game is hard, and releasing it is even harder. So let me share 10 things you can do to make the whole process a little easier. First, early in development, write down a list of every feature you want to include in your game's eventual release. I'm talking broad strokes here, let's keep it high level. The number one reason new devs say that for their first game they want to create an MMORPG with the greatest action combat known to man is because they don't understand how many things actually go into a game like that. Writing out all the high-level features you want in your game for release allows you to get a far better understanding of the true scope of the project. It also goes a long way to minimizing feature creep, which is when you continuously add more and more unplanned features throughout development. Let's take Clash of Clans as an example, since it's pretty well known. If I was setting out to make a game like Clash of Clans, here's what my high-level feature list would look like. I'd need base building, raiding, player accounts, player profiles, leaderboards, friends lists, clans, clan wars, player text chat, achievements, battle logs, and in-app purchases. Now, it's been a few years since I've played Clash of Clans, so I'm sure they've added many more features since, but you get the gist. Looking at each of these, I can already think of a ton of little sub-features that each of them is going to need. To make a leaderboard, I need a statistic or value to base the leaderboard around, so I'll need to assign a rating to each player. Then I need to decide how their rating will adjust, which in the case of Clash of Clans ties into the rating system. I'll need a rating algorithm to determine how much the statistic changes by based on each raid they carry out, as well as different leagues to put each player into based on their rating. What about the different types of leaderboards? Maybe I want to give players the options to see where they are globally as well as at a regional level. How about where they are relative to their friends, which is another feature on my list. What about their position within their league? I'd need to show them players in a given range around their rank for this kind of leaderboard. All of these high-level giga features encapsulate a ton of complexity and system design questions that need to be answered. Listing all of these features out can help you appreciate the size of the work ahead and have a think about what features are really core to the game's release. Maybe we can drop some things from this list and add them post-release. In this example, I'd probably drop leaderboards, clan wars, text chat, achievements, and battle logs from the initial feature list. These are the sort of features that aren't core to the game and can be added once you've got something out. And with the other features, I'd already be thinking about defining their exact scope so I could get a deeper understanding of the time these systems will take to implement. For me personally, I write out the core systems and then pick one to work on. Then, on the system I've chosen, I list the individual components needed to create the system and use that as my to-do list, ignoring almost everything else. I find this helps me stay focused and work on big systems without getting overwhelmed by their complexity. Right, that was a long first tip, let's do some shorter ones. Tip 2 is finding a project structure that works for you. Whatever engine you're working in, keeping your files organized will save you so much pain in the long run. Most games take months, if not years, to release, and keeping a clean structure about where you store your code, your art assets, sound files, UI components, and so on, will make you vastly more productive. There is no set structure that works for everyone, but I would encourage you to spend some time organizing your files and data in a way that makes finding things you haven't touched for months easy to locate. This goes for naming files and writing code as well. Using clear and consistent naming conventions for files, folders, and variable names will minimize the risk of you throwing your computer out the window in rage and confusion. The next tip, and in my opinion one of the most important, is ensuring you understand your core gameplay loop. Every game can be stripped down into a set of actions your players repeat over and over again. And being able to clearly articulate what those actions are in your game will help you understand whether your concept is truly compelling and something people might enjoy. In Minecraft, the gameplay loop is mining and crafting. In Tetris, you position, rotate, and place blocks. In Call of Duty, you find and shoot people. I believe that successful games need to be, above all else, engaging. If players are engaged when playing your game, then you can be confident your game will find some success. And I'm not talking about the mobile daily login reward loot box confetti kind of engagement. I'm talking about when someone plays your game, are they thinking about anything else, or are they completely engrossed in what they are playing? A fun and engaging gameplay loop will keep players so focused on your game that they won't be able to pull themselves away or think about anything else while playing. Write out your core gameplay loop and prototype around this until you find something that is truly fun to do. This will allow you to make a fun game, instead of making a game and then trying to make it fun. Right, tip 4 is a bit more practical, and that's keep things clean, but not too clean. I think most of us know when something starts feeling dirty. If you're a programmer, you know that copying walls of code to paste it somewhere else probably isn't optimal. And writing a class that does 17 different things and runs to 3,000 lines can probably be broken down and split up. You know that having a tangled web of interdependent systems is far from ideal, and you know that the complexity and workarounds you're introducing now will no doubt constrain you in the future. And it's the same with all aspects of development. Keeping things simple is of course best, but doing this isn't exactly simple. It's easy to freestyle parts of development in the name of speed and progress, but you've got to remember that the start is always the funnest part. And the reason for that is because you have next to no constraints. You're not bogged down by the stupid decisions you've made, and everything is fresh and exciting. I've found the best way to minimize the amount of technical debt and future issues is just to do some proper planning. It's not the sexiest solution, I know, but it goes a long way. Planning out in detail how your systems are going to work, thinking about how different parts of your game will interact, and doing some proper concepting for the visuals will slow your development down at the start, but speed it up in the middle. And the middle is the longest and arguably hardest part of development, so it's important to maintain momentum here. Tip 5 is related to the second part of tip 4 about not keeping things too clean. Prepare to refactor and rework parts of your game. While proper planning is important, it's easy to get stuck in that phase and never make meaningful progress. The fear of not being prepared or things not being quite perfect enough for you to get started is such a barrier to so many possible achievements. When setting out to work on something for a long period of time, it's easy to get hung up on perceived inefficiencies or your lack of knowledge and skills required to see the task through. But remember, your efficiency is irrelevant if you never finish the project. The quality of any part of your game won't matter if it never gets released. So don't let a perceived lack of preparedness stop you from starting, but instead, get ready to do things wrong, fix them later, and learn from your experience. You'll never be ready, so just do it. Okay, tip 6 is a little less preachy, and that's to lean into your passions and embrace your weaknesses. For me personally, the best part of game development is designing and writing the big complex systems. I love architecting big systems, writing it all out, and then testing and inevitably fixing all the little bugs I didn't see coming. I really relish the challenge and love discovering how the systems are working in ways I didn't fully appreciate when I wrote them. And because of this passion, I can work non-stop and implement pretty huge core systems of my games in a couple of weeks. I consider this a real strength of mine, and this is when I feel most productive. Contrast that with any work on the visuals of a game, be it UI, modeling, VFX, whatever, and it's the complete opposite. In one of my games, I designed and wrote out a relatively robust computer opponent in a day and a half that totaled a little over 1,000 lines of code. I was very new to programming at the time and had never really done anything like it before, but it was so fun that I had no problem blazing through it. In that same game, it took me over 2 weeks to design and create 6 small visual effects, each of them no more than a few seconds long, and very simple. The development was so slow because I didn't really enjoy what I was doing. And I didn't enjoy it because I wasn't very good at making VFX. Visuals have always been a weakness of mine, and it's something that I'm working on, but at the time it really bothered me about how long it was taking and how easily I would get distracted. I've learned to understand that naturally I won't be as productive when working on aspects of a game I don't enjoy as much, and to not get too hung up about it. And while that's not an excuse to slack off or ignore parts of game development you're not as fond of, it is important to accept that the process isn't all sunshine and roses. There will be parts of your game that you love working on and parts of your game that you don't. Recognize that and don't beat yourself up. Just do your best to get through it and get back to the fun stuff. Okay, 7 is heaven, and that heaven is getting feedback early. While many of the tips on this list are my personal opinions, I don't think anyone's trying to argue about the importance of getting some feedback on your game. The perspective and insight a third party can provide on your game is invaluable, and seeing how people play your game and what they think will undoubtedly make it better. In my mind, there's 2 parts to early testing. First is testing how intuitive your game is to someone that has never seen or heard about it before. This can range from the game mechanics to the UI. Just seeing what buttons players click and what order they try to do things in will give you so much information about the ways you can improve your game. Do they click a button too many times? You probably need to add a clearer response that it's been clicked. Do they try interacting with something that isn't actually interactable? Find out what about that object makes it seem like it's interactable and change it. Do they try walking in one direction before walking in another? Something about your game has probably influenced that decision, and you need to decide whether that's positive or negative. The earlier you see these things, the more development time you will save. By developing the game, you have so much acquired knowledge that you can't make accurate judgments about how intuitive or understandable your game is to players. You need feedback for this. The second part of early testing is getting feedback on the mechanics of your game and how it all works. This is valuable early on because it can inform design decisions later and help shape what your game ultimately becomes. The most valuable thing early testers can do is highlight the parts of your game they don't like. It is up to you to understand why they don't like it and make a decision about whether this part of the game can be improved. Sometimes it might just be some random quirk that's personal to them, and so the feedback is best left unactioned. but I find that more often than not, when someone dislikes a part of your game enough to voice that opinion, there's something that can be done to improve it. Getting feedback about something you care about is scary. All the self-doubts and vulnerabilities you have about your unfinished game are going to get slammed into your face. I've shown early versions of my games to friends before and been absolutely savaged. But through that savagery, those games have undoubtedly improved. So brace yourself and go get some early feedback, because it's worth it. Tip 8 is to not have sacred cows. And if you haven't heard this idiom before, then that probably sounds a bit profane. A sacred cow is something that you hold above question or criticism. In game development, this is a part of your game that you're not willing to change or remove. If you're making a game just for yourself, then this is less relevant, but your game will be the better for it if you keep an open mind to any and all parts of it. If something isn't working or you don't have the time to implement it, change it or cut it. This is especially hard for things you consider core to your game, visuals or features that you see as constituting the soul of your game. But if it's that good, it won't be criticized, and if it's criticized, you should be able to make the case for keeping it if it's really that good. Number 9 is a coding one that I think we've all heard before, and that's to ignore premature optimization, but that doesn't mean you can be lazy. I think the case for avoiding actively optimizing your game before you need to is a strong one. If it's not a problem now, there's a good chance it won't be a problem in the future, and spending time optimizing something that ultimately doesn't meaningfully affect your game's performance is wasted development time that could be spent elsewhere. However, this doesn't give us a free pass to write dumb code just because premature optimization is evil. You don't have to be actively optimizing to choose to cache your components and use a string builder. Optimization is a sliding scale. There's a big difference between doing an hour of performance profiling every time you make a commit and simply being mindful of the scalability of your code. Don't overthink it, but don't be dumb. Right, last tip, and I'm running out of things I can pretend to be knowledgeable on, so I'll keep it quick. Tip number 10 is to get on with it. At the end of the day, the only way you're going to release your game is to put the hours in. You probably overestimate how much you can achieve in a day and underestimate how much you can achieve in a year. Working on your game every day will go a long way as the months go by and your skills improve. Learn to love the process because you have no guarantee you will love the result. So good luck and have fun.